This is a box of shortcuts. It's supposed to increase your productivity by helping you create shortcuts for your most used actions. Not just keystrokes, but all kinds of actions. You can program it, for example, to switch off your PC, change the brightness on your streaming light, change scenes on OBS, type passwords, or even type paragraphs. I have previously reviewed a $27 macro pad that worked amazingly well. I mostly use it on Audacity to join clips, to split clips, or to silence gaps when doing voiceover. And it has reduced the workload significantly. So I thought, bigger is better. So I went and I bought the Loop Deck Live, which I have been eyeing for a while. And I spent a few weeks with it. In this video, we will talk about the pros and the cons and cover my experience with it. Let's go. I found that the $27 macro keypad worked extremely well. I do a lot of editing on DaVinci and Audacity. An editing session can span for up to 9 hours sometimes, and the shortcuts reduced the workload significantly and made the editing process much more enjoyable. So every keystroke counts. There's something magical about it. It feels like cheating when something that's supposed to take few steps gets done with one click. Almost like a cheat code in a game from the early 2000s. Established in 2016 in Finland, Loop Deck offers 4 different types of editing and streaming consoles. An entry-level Loop Deck Live S, I'm assuming the S stands for simple, then the Loop Deck Live, which we're reviewing today, Loop Deck CT, or creative tool, which is basically a Loop Deck Live on steroids, and finally, Loop Deck Plus. The unboxing is super simple. You get the device, a simple stand made from plastic, and a very nice braided USB-C to USB-C cable with a USB-A attachment. Let's start with the stand. At 25 degrees, it leaves a lot to be desired. I would have loved to see a more versatile stand that allows you to go from 0 to 90 degrees. This way, I can have it in between my arms when I'm editing, and I can quickly take a glance at it. Or have it at an arm's reach at around 45 degrees, like how a streamer would use it. I can still see the logic as to why they picked the 25 degrees. If you can only pick one fixed position, you want something in the middle. I do think it would have made a lot more sense if they sold an optional stand at 45 or 65 degrees. It feels like a missed opportunity to upsell, in my opinion. If you're not happy with it, you can buy a 3D printed stand from Etsy or eBay and support small business owners. Some of these stands are very creative, like this one here with a drawer sliding swivel action. The reason why I started with the stand is because it makes all the difference when it comes to visibility. If the device is too close to you, the stand is too high. If it's too far, the stand is too low. So having an adjustable stand makes all the difference when it comes to visibility. Moving on to the star of the show, the Loop Deck Live itself. Although it feels premium, I think it's a little bit overpriced in my opinion, especially with its direct competitor, Elgato Stream Deck Plus, priced at just $179 versus the $269 asking price from Loop Deck. But as a business, I understand why they're pricing it this way, as there aren't that many true competitors in this type of consoles. Now let's talk about the software experience. There's a great deal of thought that went into the creation of the software. As an example only, the console, with the help of the software, can recognize the difference between plugging it into a running PC and a powered USB hub that's connected to nothing. The interface will only turn on if it's actually connected to a PC. Sounds small, but for an editing and streaming device, every little action matters. With this level of integration and software genius, it feels organic and seamless to use. There's also a marketplace where you can go and download profiles for free to save yourself time and have some professionally made shortcuts. It's not super big compared to competition, but for the most part, you will find what you need there. Just a small tip, make sure you turn on the haptic or vibration feedback on. For some reason, my console had this option turned off from the factory. I'll admit that I felt that the software experience as a whole felt very complicated to me. It's been a week now and I'm still not 100% confident on how to run certain applications. Not that I can't, but it just requires more research and watching a few more videos. I understand that as a streamer or an editor, you are expected to be good with technology, but to me, it felt a little difficult. This is not a contradiction to my earlier statement. There's a lot of thoughts that went into the software to give the user more creative freedom and options. But with more options come more complications. As an example, I wanted to have a button for DaVinci Resolve. Click to open. That's it. But for some reason, I can't find it. I did manage to have one by going to the properties and assign a shortcut to the program, and then go to the LoopDeck software and add the button manually. Now you would think that with an entire profile dedicated to DaVinci Resolve available on the marketplace, this stuff is trivial, but it's not. I'm sure there's a simpler way to do it, but I just haven't found out how to do it yet. If you know how to, please let me know in the comments. Biggest area of improvement. One more complaint that I have, and this is my biggest complaint. It's the touchscreen. This device would have been an Elgato killer if it had a physical button with an LCD baked into it. Everything on this device is almost perfect, except the part that matters the most. I find myself more often than I would like, accidentally pressing buttons while moving it around or while using the dial to adjust something. This can be extremely frustrating, as sometimes you will press a button and not even know it, until you finish editing a 6 hours video and find out that you moved or deleted something that you were not supposed to. In the end, let me leave you with this. Although I found out about all these cons early on, during the time I still had an opportunity to return it, I chose to keep it. Although not perfect and have few obvious areas to improve on in the future, I think it's a great device and I'm definitely keeping it. I'm an absolute fan of the design. If I learned something from using tech products, is that sometimes you don't get to fully understand and appreciate a product until you have spent months and years with it. It might not have lived up to my expectations, but I'm willing to give it a little more time to prove itself. I have a video coming up on the following subjects. So if this is your kind of thing, keep an eye on the channel for future videos. That's been it. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll catch you in the next video.